attention.
Would everyone please rise for the sounding of the shofar? Thank you.
Yeah.
for the rich man's gold. All that you need is in God's control. And you can do this, now if you try.
Zip line going on and
people flipping over in kayaks.
Is there a champion in our midst?
Yes, there is a champion in your midst. I won the belly flop contest.
Yeah!
However, I was the only one participating.
You're still a winner.
So I'm still a winner.
Everyone gets a trophy.
Yep. But anyway, the announcements for this week. On Tuesday nights, we have our prayer at 6 o'clock. At 7, what Bible study is going on now, anything?
Financial
aid. Still doing the financial aid.
Peace.
Peace. Financial peace.
Which gives you aid.
Which gives you aid, yes. And then there's the NA at 7:45 in here. Friday nights, here. Working on something for the next free gathering. Can't figure out what it is going to be yet, but it'll be sometime in this month. And on Sunday mornings, men's Bible study.
8 a.m.
8 a.m. Here, right. We meet. We go. We have breakfast. We read the Word. We have great fellowship, a good breakfast. Well, a great breakfast, actually. So, come on. Try it one time, guys. One time.
Where's you'll like it. Try it. You'll like it.
Yeah. The worst that's going to happen is you're going to get a good meal and good fellowship. Yeah? So anyway, I guess that's what I got. And I guess Pastor Deb's coming up.
Woo! Woo!
Usually Roadblock does our announcements, but this one just would have taken too much paper to put down for him. So we've actually, in the meantime, if the ushers could come up.
Ushers.
We have received donations of a large amount of baby food, baby formula, like some
snacks,
granola bars, sodas, and we received them to give out. But we received them to give out to what they call stakeholders in the town. So people in the town that this is their town and they're serving the community and they're reaching out to people. So we want to find the stakeholders, whether it's like the school nurse, the firemen, or just somebody that's organizing like single mothers or something like that. We want to find the ones that are organizing these things and get some of this product out to them so that, you know, a church is giving out. That's all. And so we need anybody that's interested in helping out with this, has any ideas, or just wants to go along with someone else that has ideas. We will meet next Tuesday at 5 p.m. just to kind of get a who's who of what's going on, and then we'll get it out to you guys of who's doing what, and then more people can join them also if they want.
Where are we meeting?
We're meeting here because prayer is at 6, and
right.
You know,
yes.
That just works that way.
Yes.
All right, so that anyone that wants to join us, it's Tuesday, 5 o'clock, then prayer, then study, then any, whatever you guys want. The ushers are here. Guys, I want to thank you for your service. You guys are like always there, as soon as we call. Lord, I just want to thank you most of all. Thank you for the hearts of the people that give unto you or unto this church for the work that's being done. We just thank you, Lord, that you have promised us that this is an area that we can test you in, that you will not let us down, and that we are giving out of just, we may not have excess, but we'll give out of our hearts, and you'll bless us there.
Yes,
and so we just want to thank you and ask you to just increase this in anyone's life that is given, Lord. Just increase what they've given back to them, and let them just see in miraculous ways that they'll be able to tell other people about the action that comes out of our Lord. In your name, Lord Jesus, amen.
Amen.
And now we can have Tom.
Yay.
Tom.
Well. You just never know what you're going to get at Broken Chains, huh? Yes, Dave. Oh, Dave, come on up. You've got something to say? Now that you have a voice.
Test 1, 2.
Introduce yourself, they might not know you.
My name's David.
Crazy Dave.
It's Wednesday evening, we are doing our annual Thanksgiving gathering of just friends that we've mingled with or met or have a place to go. Thursday, we're going to have some tasty food, some tasty conversations, and you would be highly surprised who don't have a place to go this year. They were amongst us, so I'm opening this place Wednesday, 5 o'clock to whenever. There's some veterans coming, there's a bunch of people just coming to just say thank you to each other. You want to come, come. If not, I'll take a $20 donation.
Is that it?
Wednesday?
All right, so that, you know, Crazy Dave and Frank and Shinin again are doing some Christmas thing too. So thank you, Jesus, for gathering us here today. And thank you. You know, all you folks watching on live stream, we're so excited you're here. I know you can't recognize me with my glasses on, but we'll figure that out. I want you guys on live stream to know that we recently learned that we need some kind of zippity-doo-dah something cards in our computers that then can get to the HD blah, 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 so that your service will be uninterrupted. So we're hopeful that you're uninterrupted tonight. And soon Steve Elaine will walk in with that stuff and stick it in the computer and woo! All right, so yeah, the guys and I went on a men's retreat this last weekend up to Monadnock Bible Conference. Yeah. And it was pretty awesome. And I've been thinking about it all week, and I thought, you know, I'm going to take the notes out from that four-day conference. I'm going to take three days. We take those four sessions and boil them down into one brief, concise sermon.
Oh, yeah.
Or somewhat long and involved, but Allie, next slide, please. So this was the name of the thing. Do you have true grit? Now, when I was researching these pictures, I found out they redid this movie, you know. Someone other than John Wayne, you know, like, some other guy, whatever. Clearly, it was not working. So, next slide, please. We're doing this this way. So, this is what grit stands for, all right? God forgives, do you? That was our first session. Real men lust. Oh, my. Oh, look, and real men can't spell. I will not quit. And total destruction. So those were the four sessions, and they were pretty, where I was left with some stuff to ponder in my prayer dump truck all week. And so I'm going to share some of that ponderance with you guys, because I was left really kind of wrestling through some particular items, and we'll get to, and I really kind of expect that most of us are going to feel some conviction in the room. So prepare yourself for a spiritual awakening, and then great news, Jesus loves you, so it's all going to be great, all right?
Yeah.
All right. So real men forgive, right? God forgives to you. So this particular session, I have to look up my Bible app here, because I'm going to go through some little blurry scriptures. You'll notice that I have my light enhancers on. And we're going to be turning to Matthew 18, verses 21 to 35. So there we go. This thing's so great. I love this thing. And I'm going to read from the New International, just so you know what it says. So Matthew 18, 21 to 25. Now normally when I think of 18, I think about when you have a problem with your brother, you go speak to him, but this is a little different thing. So Matthew 18, yeah, 21, there we go. Oh, so Peter came to Jesus and asked the Lord, "How many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times?" And Jesus then answered, "I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants, and he began to the settlement, as he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and children all had to be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. "Be patient with me," he begged. "I'll pay you back everything." And the servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. And of course, the grateful servant went out. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. "Pay back what you owe me." His fellow servant fell on his knees and begged him, "Please be patient with me, I'll pay it back." But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown in prison until he could pay the debt. And when the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said, "I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me." And by the way, that was a debt that would be impossible for him to pay in his lifetime. "Because you begged me to, shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. And this is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. Yeah, he said that. So next slide. I think I'm doing pretty good with these.
You're doing pretty good.
Oh yeah, dealing with unforgiveness. Okay, next slide. All right, good. All right, we're in the right place. So from the human perspective, there's a limit to our ability to forgive. Well, you know, I have rights and I can't forgive on this side of heaven, and forgiveness is really more of an ideal than a command, you know. And these are some of the things that, but, you know, God's perspective is we're to forgive with the same measure that he has forgiven us. Oh. Yeah, you know, Father, forgive our trespasses as we forgive those. Can you imagine if you can't get in heaven because you haven't forgiven others as you've been forgiven by God? Oh, ouch. Here, great news. He reviewed what forgiveness is not. This is Pastor Rick. So this is from his notes. It does not mean to pretend there's not a debt to pay. It does not mean there's no pain. It does not mean approving of what someone else did. It does not mean making excuses for other people's bad behavior. It does not mean overlooking abuse. It does not mean denying that others tried to hurt you repeatedly. It does not mean letting others walk all over you. It does not mean refusing to press charges when a crime has been committed. It does not mean that all the negative consequences of sin are canceled. But from God's perspective, what is forgiveness? Let's see what the next one says. Oh, no, that's not it. Okay, go back. We're not coming that way. Okay, good. So what's forgiveness? And forgiveness is releasing the debt they owe you and giving it to God to deal with it the way he wants.
What?
Well, yeah, but you don't know what Dave said. And look, there are consequences for our unforgiveness. If we turn to Psalm 32, let's see if I can do this in my fancy device. Go to Psalm 32, verses 1 through 4. Yeah. Psalm 32, 1 through 4. And I'm going to again use NIV. Oh, that's so fancy. "Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me, and my strength was sapped as in the heat of summer." See, there's an unforgiving spirit actually destroys us physically. So blessed where there is no iniquity. An unforgiving Christian will generally be unhappy. Where there's no guile, in verse 2, or deception, an unforgiving Christian will destroy their own integrity. My bones waxed old, or my bones groaned and wasted away. An unforgiving Christian will be miserable. My moisture has turned to the drought of summer. An unforgiving Christian will be affected physically. It's just going to wear you out. And then ultimately, God does resist the proud. So an unforgiving Christian can fall quickly into immorality. So we're required to forgive. We're required, we're commanded to forgive. An unforgiving spirit destroys us emotionally, and bitterness forms rejection. As someone once said, the bitterness is you drinking the poison, hoping the other person dies.
What?
Yeah. So here's some of the other symptoms. Your wrath will become a loss of temper. Your anger will turn into vengeance. Your clamor, you'll argue and fight. You'll slander with abusive speech. You'll be malicious, and you'll have an irrational intent to hurt another. The unforgiving spirit destroys fellowship with God. We can't have fellowship with God when we don't have fellowship with one another. It just won't work. When we don't forgive others, we set ourselves as a higher judge than God. And remember, God has forgiven us our sins. And I have a lot to be forgiven. And in light of that fact, I have to forgive others. I have to. Or there'll be consequences. It's a commandment of God. He wants forgiveness from our heart. And that means releasing a debt they owe you and giving it to God to handle any way he wants. He takes the issue of forgiveness very seriously. And so it's something that we have to learn to practice. And it's a matter of obedience. It's simply a matter of obedience, and it's not easy, but the power of the Holy Spirit will carry us there. So let's go to the next slide. This one, you know, everybody freaked out, real men lust. And this goes to James 1. Boy, yeah, this is going so smoothly. James 1, verses 5 through 27. All right, you guys there? If any of you lacks wisdom, let them ask of God, who gives to all liberally without reproach, and it will be given to him. And let him ask in faith with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded and unstable in all his ways. Let the lowly brother glory in his exaltation, but the rich in his humiliation, because as a flower of the field will pass away, no sooner has the sun risen with the burning heat than it withers of the grass, its flower falls, and its beautiful appearance perishes. Look, I'm going to pick up there. So wisdom is the ability to choose the best goals and the best path for those goals. And wisdom is the stuff where we get acquainted with the principles of God. And we get acquainted with his instruction and maybe even correction. Wisdom means that we're going to listen to that person that will approach us in brotherly or sisterly love and say, hey, I don't know if you've noticed, but this is something that I've seen you struggling with or doing, and it's not godly. This is not from God. Maybe we're drinking, or maybe we're drugging, or maybe, who knows what we're doing. Wisdom will give us discernment and understanding and knowledge. And there are five steps that will destroy our life if we don't act wisely. So the first thing is being double-minded, as it says in James. It literally means being two-souled. And you're vacillating between the two, trying to blend together God's will and your will. Now we're going to get to the point, the thing I've wrestled with most from this weekend is the whole concept of dying to self. And this is where our struggle always lies. That when I'm struggling against God for my will, whether it's unforgiveness or whether I'm lusting for the things of the world or lusting on the computer screen or driving by the wherever naked girls hang out or any of that kind of stuff, or guys, you know, that that double-mindedness, we're warring with our flesh, and the flesh is trying to consume us, but we're to be a new creation. We're supposed to die to our flesh and to live in Christ. And when we find ourselves in that battle, often we've already lost because we're already there. We're in trials all the time because we'll be tempted. And God's purpose in trials is never to lead us into sin, but to strengthen us. But when we don't choose God's way, it always ends in sin. So are we double-minded? And how are we doing with the trials? You know, I've had a couple of trials this year, and I haven't done that well. God's will and my will, and my will was really getting very upset. And finally, I had my breakthroughs, and I continue to understand that I really need to trust God and grow in my faith and die to my fleshly desires. Okay. And trust that he's put me exactly where he wants me to be, to do exactly what he wants done. One of the other things that will come up is there's this thing called desire, and when we have a desire, we're being carried away or drawn out, and we'll often make choices according to our feelings. You know, if it feels good, do it. Oh, danger approaching. And when we choose to live by wisdom, we're going to avoid becoming double-minded. Because the decisions we need to make are not based in our feelings, but based in the truth of God's word. And if we find ourselves making decisions on our feelings, then we're living in a place of deception. And that deception will lead us down roads that'll tank our families, they'll tank our finances, they'll mess with the direction that God has in our lives. And in that deception, we find ourselves in disobedience. And then we're rationalizing it all away, where it's easier to sin and rationalize. And we allow our emotions to dictate our direction. And finally, that ends in death. Sin starts out feeling good, but always ends up in death. The payment is death. It'll be death of our integrity, death of our character, death of our walk with the Lord, death of our calling. Great news, you can restore all this. Whew, that was close. You dodged a bullet, Dave. That was good. So the first thing is that this Pastor Rick said is you need to look up in faith. Belief is always the best way to obey God, even when I don't understand. And my behavior, I'm dead to that. I'm dead to that. You know what? I am wild about my wife. I know I talk about this every week, but I'm wild about my wife. And part of the reason I stay engaged in that place is I don't have eyes for anyone else. I'm not looking over the fence. I'm not checking out the latest whatever. I sit there sometimes in CBS and I look at those magazines of a whole bunch of people I don't know and think, I don't know who these people are, but it'd be nice if they got some clothes.
It's true.
Yeah, so, but I don't know who they are. And you know why I don't know who they are? Because I don't pursue any of that. You know, I pursue my wife, which is hard enough. I mean, I can catch her because she's, you know, slower than me. The second thing is, You need to look down. You need to go to your friends. So you're looking up to God. You're looking down to your friends. You believe that a good friend will love me enough to rebuke me. And then I'll have a behavior change. I'll confess my faults to a friend. And look, it's one thing to say, oh, Dave, I've been lusting in my heart and I've been doing these bad things. And call him Dave 18 times. Dave, I've been lusting in my heart. And eventually Dave's going to say, it's great that you confessed that, but clearly there's no repentance, which means turning from that. So how can I walk with you into the repentance place? The third thing he said is, look out, flee. You remember when Joseph was being, you know, tempted by Potiphar's wife, said, come and lay with me. And he ran away and she took his cloak and he ran away naked. Flee. And this is what, you know, often in the Bible says, stand firm, except when a chick is chasing a dude. When a chick is chasing a dude, flee, it says. Flee. Run, man. You will be like an ox to the slaughter. This is where the Bible says, a harlot will reduce a man to a loaf of bread. You know what goes on in strip joints. Some of you used to go there. Why do you put dollars in? Loaf of bread. Loaf of bread. Loaf of bread. Loaf of bread. You have become a means to an end. And you're the sucker. Flee and save yourself. And look, I have to believe that I'm weak and I can't handle being around sin. There's just some sin I cannot be around. I'm not to be judgmental. I just can't be in that scene, man. If I'm at a club event and the strippers are on their way, I'm out. I'm out. Have a good day. So long, fellas. Back often, they would warn us, right, Ken? They'd say, hey, by the way, strippers are due here in 10 minutes. We'd be like, I'm out. That's not a place for me to be as a man of God. It's not a place for women to be. By the way, there are strip clubs for women to go to see men. Yes, that happens. So flee. And so I will not place myself in danger. And when I am in danger, I need to run. So if you're cruising through the combat zone and they're inviting you into that movie, don't go, run. You're cruising through your computer, you know, everybody on Facebook, at some point, somebody on our Facebook, at least on mine, every now and then, some knucklehead puts something up, and I'm like, I am not clicking on that video. Because I know where that video goes. I will flee from it. And then we have to look in, we have to fortify. We have to believe that if I don't put up safeguards, I'm going to lose this battle. That's why so many men are encouraged to use a program called Covenant Eyes and work with one another. This program called Covenant Eyes will block all the porn and stuff that you could fall into. And you'll find out that there's been some stuff that you didn't think was porn that's been making its way in, just slowly preparing the way for you to fall. And I'll discipline myself in God's word. One of the great things about driving a truck is some years ago, Allie, let's see what the next slide is. Yeah, okay, good, that's good. We need to be there. That's awesome. I forgot what I made. One of the great things, years ago I had a pastor who had been raised as a pastor's kid, had been raised in church. He went to school to become a pastor. He became a pastor at a young age. He was always a pastor. And when I would talk to him, he had a really unrealistic view of my life as a working dude. You know what I mean? And every now and then I said, you know, every now and then you should go work a job for like 6 months. Just so you know what it's like for a dude who gets up at 4 a.m. and goes and slugs it out, maybe 10 or 12 hours that day, and then comes to meetings and comes to all this stuff, you know, it'd just be helpful. Because we pastors always say, start your day in prayer, start your day in the Word. Well, at 4 a.m., that takes some serious discipline. Now, I do, and I have, but I, you know, my first few weeks working and getting up so early, I stumbled around with that. And you know what happens when I don't read the Word of God? I get a little bit grumpy. I get a little bit self-focused. I begin to whine and carry on. That probably doesn't happen to you, because you guys are all in the Word every morning. You're in prayer in the Word every morning, which would save you from that. But if you find yourself wading into those waters that you're embarrassing yourself by your behavior, the Lord's usually saying, hello, McFly, why don't you turn in to www.jesus.com and let's hang out for a little while. I'll pour some of my wisdom and my love into you, and then you'll go out and you won't be that way, but you'll be Yahweh. You know what I'm saying? All right. So the next one is, I will not quit. Now, we turn to Nehemiah 4, chapter 4, verses 1 through 23. And this is a section where Nehemiah is going to build the wall, right? And that whole study on building the wall is how to fortify the church, how to stand tall, what do we do, how do we approach this. And if we do this right, revival will come in the restoration of strength and passion by applying the principles of God. And I'm praying for a revival. And sometimes opposition is not only an evidence that God's blessing, but an opportunity for us to grow. If you feel opposed and pushed back, I have a note he gave us. Christians discourage you out of envy of anointing and passion, and we disrupt their comfortable lifestyle. If you are anointed and appointed and you're reaching out to the world around you, there's going to be people who discourage you. And I never could understand, dude, what? Look, man, we're on the same team. Why would you? And now I realize, well, of course they want to discourage you because they're much happier on the sofa doing nothing or not showing up to anything, but having the label of being a Christian. Oh, I'm a Christian. I'm wearing a Christian shirt and everything. Well, they're a do-nothing Christian. And we're called to go out. We're called to make a difference. We're called to impact the world. And if we're impacting, there'll always be a Christian saying, well, I don't think you're doing that right. You know what? I might not be doing it right, but I'm doing it. Right. You're watching TV. I hope the Patriots win, but I'm going where Jesus went. All right, I'm getting a little carried away. Here's a great quote from Charles Spurgeon. God had one son without sin, but he never had a son without a trial. Yeah, the battle was more in changing one's belief of declaring the truth. So, Nehemiah, let's see what we have in Nehemiah. So when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and greatly incensed. What, are you going to rebuild the wall? I'm watching TV. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, what are those feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burned as they are? Tobiah the Amorite, who was at his side, said, what are they building? Even a fox climbing up on it would break down their wall of stones. And here's what Nehemiah does. So the world wants you to quit. The world wants to ridicule you. They want to push you back. But your response always has to be, hear us, O God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in the land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight. For they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. Yeah. And so we rebuilt the wall till all of it reached half of its height. So the people worked with all their heart. And then in verse 7 and 8, we're going to hear about rejection. But then that response, and then Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabs and the Ammonites and the people of Ashdod heard the repairs of Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead and the gaps were being closed, and they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. But we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. Meanwhile, the people in Judah said, the strength of the laborers is giving out. There's so much rubble, they can't rebuild it. And also our enemy said, before they know it or see us, we'll be right there among them and we'll kill them and put an end to all this. And the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over, wherever you turn, they're going to attack us. Therefore, I stationed some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall and the exposed places, posted them by their families and with swords and spears and bows. After I looked things over, I stood up and said to the nobles and the officials and the rest of the people, don't be afraid of them. Remember, the Lord who is great and awesome, and he will fight for your families and for your sons and daughters and your wives and homes. And our enemies heard that we were aware of their plot and that God had frustrated it, and we returned to the wall, each to our own work. From that day on, half of the men did the work. The other half were equipped with spears and shields and bows and armor. The officers posted themselves behind the people of Judah, and they were building the wall. And those who carried materials did their work with one hand and held a weapon in the other. And each of the builders wore his sword on his side as he worked. But the man who sounded this trumpet stayed with me. Look, man, they had a loss of strength. They had a loss of vision. They had a loss of confidence. Even their own friends were telling them, maybe we should quit. Their enemies were against them. And Nehemiah had to examine the situation and make the right changes. And the first change he made was, oh God, tell me what I'm supposed to do. We found in our research studies that a signature of mediocrity is not an unwillingness to change. The signature of mediocrity is chronic inconsistency. It's a great choice by Jim Collins. Inconsistency. If we will consistently do what God has called us to do, if we will continue to work on that wall and carry the sword, he will carry us through. But if we work on the wall a little bit today and we flit and float and do some other thing, that inconsistency ruins our witness. We have to be willing. Oh, let's try the next one, LA. Yeah, good. Oh, good. So we have to re-examine ourselves. What are the brutal facts about my life that need to change? And then maybe we need to refocus. Is life all about you or is it all about God? Ouch, because these are beginning to sting. Hey, we got to retool. Are you willing to fight? And are you willing to build? And maybe you need to retreat. Maybe you got to get out and go to a men's retreat and get your spirit refilled where you can encourage one another. And then review. It's all about the glory of God. It's not about me. The conclusion in Nehemiah 6:15 was, so the wall was finished. It took 52 days. 52 days. Because they were dedicated. The Lord demonstrated his faithfulness. And they drove on. So then, let's see what the next slide says. I think it's total. Yes, total destruction. So exciting. What a great title. That's so good. Total destruction. So the path, here's a great quote. The path of revival will be a journey that none would choose but all desire. Intimacy with the Lord. And the pathway to revival is not done half-step in Jesus. It's not done showing up at church and then the rest of the week living like hell. The pathway to revival is intimacy with the Lord and walking it out with him. Let's see what the next thing says. Oh, yes. The death of Jesus is over the penalty of sin. But here, this is the one, death of self is over the power of sin. So there, these two deaths are required for revival. If we only have one, if we've turned our life to Jesus Christ, he's done all the work, it's easy, I said the words, I'm saved now. But in my salvation, I've got to die to myself and my selfish desires. And tell me, you know, this has been kicking my butt in this truck every day. It's been kicking my butt since I listened to it. I don't want to die to myself. I don't want to go through, if you look at 1 Samuel, I'm not going to read it, but 1 Samuel chapters 18 to 21, you have David. And David's chosen, hey man, you're going to be king. Awesome, that's great. Then the king loves him. The king's like, hey man, you're awesome. Come hang out with me. And then the people are like, David's killed 10,000 and Saul's only killed this many. And whoa, David's awesome. And then that's his life. Oh, go ahead. Go to the next thing. Yeah. So he's exalted by the king, loved by the country. Oh, and I forgot that he's esteemed by his enemies. All of his enemies say, wow, that David, he's something. That David's all right. All right, let's go to the next one. But then we find that David loses his position. Remember, he's being chased by Saul. He lives in caves. He's hanging out with ne'er-do-wells and scallywags. He's got the loss of relationship. Remember his wife, Micah, narked him out. Well, she made an idol in the bed, but then later he said, oh yeah, day split, so sorry. Narked him out, so goodbye to the wife. Loss of a mentor, Samuel, even turned his back on him in a moment. And so now he's facing humiliation and rejection and insecurity, and then the loss of his best friend. Remember, he goes to Jonathan and says, dude, your father's trying to kill me. Jonathan's like, no way! You're crazy, man! And David has to leave disappointed that his best friend didn't listen. And then he gets to this point that he has to act like a madman so that he could go be with the enemies where he'd be protected. And so he loses all of his self-esteem and his pride. Now, maybe you've gone through some humiliation. Maybe you've gone through some rejection. Maybe you're feeling insecure. Maybe you've been through some disappointment, or maybe there's just been some pride busters. But all of this was being done so that David could actually die to himself and be who God elevated him to be. So maybe if you're going through that stuff, you're on course for where the Lord's taking. Amen. This is often not a popularity contest. These last few lines about death to self, really, they bothered me. A.W. Tozer, well, let's see. The first problem is that our attitude towards sin is more self-centered than God-centered. We're more concerned about our own victory over sin than we are about the fact that our sins grieve God to the heart. We can't tolerate failure in our struggle with sin chiefly because we're success-oriented, not because we know it's an offense to God. Our sin is an offense to God. A.W. Tozer said, these usurpers will not just give up and die. They must be extracted like teeth from a jaw. Our old nature won't just lay down and die. There'll be ripping and tearing effect, which is sometimes painful to allow once again God's rightful place. So what does it mean to die to self? When you're forgotten or neglected or purposely set at naught, and you sting and hurt with the insult of the oversight, but your heart is happy being counted worthy to suffer for Christ, that's being dead to self. When your good is evil spoken of, when your wishes are crossed, your advice disregarded, your opinions ridicule, and you refuse to let anger rise in your heart or even defend yourself, but take it all in patient, loving silence. That is being dead to the self. How we do it. Damn you, Facebook. When you lovingly and patiently bear any disorder, any irregularity, any annoyance, when you can stand face to face with waste and folly, extravagance, spiritual insensibility, and endure it as Jesus endured it, that is being dead to self. When you're content with any food, any offering, any raiment, any climate, any society, any attitude, any interruption by the will of God, that is dying to self. When you see your brother prosper and have his needs met, and can honestly rejoice with him in the Spirit and feel no envy nor question God, while your own needs are far greater and you're in desperate circumstances, that is being dead to self. Yeah. When you can receive correction and reproof from someone with less stature than yourself, and you can humbly submit inwardly as well as outwardly, finding no rebellion or resentment rising up within your heart, that is dying to self. Next slide, let's see what we got. Oh, good. The old man is who dies when we get saved. But if there's anyone that we resurrect regularly, it's the old man. Next slide. But Jesus is trying to get us to break out of that place, to be forgiven, and to truly die to ourselves. I was in this dying to self class, and God was hitting me between the eyes. I'm living where I don't want to live. I'm living like I don't want to live. I'm doing stuff I don't want to do. My flesh has been crying out. And the Lord's saying, I put you there. I gave you that child. I provide for your needs. I put you there. Who are you going to worship? You or me? I gave you that job to provide for your family. I gave you that place. I gave you that purpose. Who are you going to worship? You or me? And if you don't feel conviction at the end of this, then your hearts are dry and cold. But I know the Holy Spirit was talking to me. And I sense that he's talking to all of us. We're moving into the Revelation studies and sermon series. And as I prepare for them, it's all about the holiness of Jesus Christ, the return of Jesus Christ. His hope for us is so great. And we settle for this when he's got this. Amen. We hang on to the temporal, and he's trying to give us the eternal. Amen. We hang on to the flesh, and he wants to give us the Spirit of the living God. Amen. We hang on to the gold and silver of this world, and he uses that for pavement back home. Right. I can't wait to do a smoke show on Gold Street. Dude, that's going to be awesome. Look, life in Christ is not just, as I think Debbie said, butterflies and unicorns. It's not. Once we realize how desperately we need a Savior, that we can't do it on our own, we're not good enough on our own, I need the forgiveness of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who took my sin. Now, the next thing is, be a simple kind of man. Be sanctified, said Eric. Sanctification is dying to ourself. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean that we're doormats.
Yep.
That doesn't mean that we get abused by everybody.
Not happening.
But it does mean I'm going to forgive those who don't deserve it.
Yeah.
I'm going to stand and I'm not going to quit. I'm going to continue to drive on.
Yep.
I'm going to pray blessings on those who curse me. And I'm going to continue in the word and the power of God to be who he's called me to be. In humility and love. And that, when we can love everyone around us, we got trouble with thugs in our, where we live. And I haven't been very loving. I've actually been prepared to deal with it in my flesh. Because it's expedient. But maybe, just me, Lord's calling me to do something different.
Yes. Amen.
So I love you guys. That's what we went over. You know, that we got to deal with our lust issues. We got to deal with our forgiveness. We got to not quit. And total destruction will come if we cannot and will not die to ourselves. The Lord has empowered us with the Holy Spirit to make it easy for us to actually die to ourselves. If we're struggling, then we need to ask that Holy Spirit and his presence. We have to ask to be baptized in that Spirit and turn away from the stuff that's dragging us away. The world intends to destroy us. Satan intends to destroy us. And it's only when we will rise up in the power of who we are in Christ that it will make a difference in our life and the lives of the people around us. True revival will come when we are restored. The stones will be brought to life. They'll all cry out to the Lord. He's returning. When we start this Revelation study on Tuesday nights at the end of the financial peace thing, you're going to be blown away at how many of the prophecies are being fulfilled right now in our very lives. I get goosebumps. Because the Lord's return is imminent.
Yes.
Imminent. And we have friends and family who will deny Christ. They'll deny God. One of my friends I was talking to him at work, and he was coming up from Florida when all that flooding was going on. He said, "How could God allow this?" I said, "God's trying to get our attention." Well, I'm mad at God, and that's the unrepentant heart. God has revealed himself. He doesn't want all this stuff to happen, but when he does, he says, repent of your sin. Turn from it. And this is what Revelation says, and their hearts were hardened. And no matter what came on them, they denied him and they cursed God. How many people are cursing God in our culture right now? Unrepentant hearts. And our duty and our job is to reach out in love to this lost and crushed and broken world that would rather curse God than repent of our sinfulness and ask for his forgiveness. So go, therefore, into all the nations. Bring the good news. Baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Preach the gospel. Go out this week and make a difference. I'm so thankful for you guys. I'm thankful for this month. I'm thankful for all you folks on live stream. If you feel like you want to sow into this ministry, go to www.brokenchainsbikerchurch.org. Click on donate and give to the ministry. By the way, just as a quick update, the matching fund, this matching fund for the pastor's housing, we're hovering somewhere around $5,000. We're a little behind on figure that out, but somewhere around $5,000. We have a year to come up with $12,000, and I've asked our presbyters to wait until we have $12,000 before they match anything. So we have a ways to go. We're nearly halfway there, but every donation you make to that is double. So I just ask you, please, to continue to pour that out. I am not going to continue living the way that we're living. But that's because God is providing a way. In 2017, we're not going to be living in two rooms in somebody's house or the basement of somebody else's house. As much of a blessing as that has been, God is going to provide for us in a miraculous way, but you're part of that miracle. Yes. So thank you. Thank you all. We love you guys. If you need prayer, if you need counsel, if you need a word, if you need somebody just to stand with you and believe with you or walk through the fire with you, please come up, see Dave or see Louise or Eric or me or Debbie. Come and feed on the power of the living God. I love you guys. God bless you. Have a great night. Have a great Thanksgiving. We'll see you Friday night after Thanksgiving. Or you'll watch on live stream. But I hope we'll see you. And by the way, the Holy Spirit Conference is going on at South Shore Community Church. That's where a lot of our folks are tonight, is they're at the Holy Spirit Experience at South Shore Community Church. So if you want to go get loaded up with the Holy Ghost tonight, tomorrow, Sunday, go load up. It's an awesome experience. I know that's where Frank is right now. He's been Mr. Soul Care Extraordinaire, and he's been filling up with the Holy Spirit, and he's getting prepared for his call for ministry. I know that Lisa's probably there and a couple of others. They just want to be filled with the Holy Spirit to be able to walk out this life in Christ. I love you guys. Thank you for putting up with me. I love you all. Have a great night.